together in our own home Sunday. I hope almost all of you, I know we ran out just at the end, but I hope most everybody has a home. And in a little bit, we're going to have a home parade. So that's while we're singing. And so those of you that have one, those of you that don't have one, if you're sitting next to somebody who doesn't, pull off a couple of these and give them a couple of words so that we can all share together in this. But we're going to be a part of the parade as we come together on this Palm Sunday. We're good, we're glad to be able to worship together. Our church's mission is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And the way that we do that is that we love God, we love others, and we serve others. Please be sure you have your little yellow connection card and to fill it out so to make sure everybody who's present today has your name written down, and also if you have any care concerns, put that on the back side. Please notice your list of announcements in the back of your worship folder, and mine is orange, but maybe yours is another color. It seems like I saw another color drop down. But we also have a group of youth announcements. Today is the last Boy Scout meal of the season. You're invited to come and be a part of that after worship. Our Holy Week services begin on Thursday. There's a 6 o'clock meal over in the education building, and then we have a 7 o'clock service here in the sanctuary. So you're all welcome to come and be a part of the meal, and I hope that you'll come. If you can't come until later, come and be a part of the worship service here. So also on Good Friday, we have services with the Church of the Brethren. That's offered by the Ministerial Association. So there are several pastors, about 6, I think, who will be a part of that, including me. And our choir will be present and doing that as well. Easter Sunday, we have our normal services at 8 and 10:30 with a continental breakfast in between. Sunday after Easter, we'll be getting the study and scripture. The message is focused on the story, and those resources are available for you at the end of the service afterwards. I'll have you look through those other things, except Sherry has a word for you from Prayer and Share.
As a member of the board of Prayer and Share Ministries, I have tickets for their annual appreciation dinner for their members and volunteers. It's Tuesday, the 18th of April, dinner at 6, doors open at 5:30, tickets are $15. And it would be a great opportunity for anyone who is a little unsure about what Care and Share does to go and find out and enjoy a great meal at Pretty Lake Methodist Church. If you need tickets or would like them, please see me in the back afterwards. And their general thing was, if you can't sell them, see if people would like to donate for this. And this is one of our big things that we really contribute a lot to. So I have tickets to see in the back half. Thank you.
Thank you, Sherry. The Lord be with you. Let us worship together. the children's message, and if you weren't a part of the palm parade and you're still in the congregation and you're a child, you're welcome to come forward at this time as well.
Okay. Well, they're getting settled. When we get to the part of the story, this is an audience participation, so I'll explain to everybody what you're going to do. How do we celebrate? What do? When we show signs of celebrating? Can you tell? We celebrate birthdays. How do we celebrate? What's something we do when we celebrate birthdays? We sing happy birthday. We sing songs. What's another way we celebrate? Something, somebody does something very well, what do we do for them sometimes? Celebrate. How do we celebrate? Do we clap our hands? Show me how you clap your hands. Okay. I like to say woohoo when I'm celebrating. Can everybody say woohoo? Okay, today is Palm Sunday. It is a day when we remember how people celebrated when Jesus entered in Jerusalem on a Sunday some 2,000 years ago. You've probably heard the story, but let me tell it again. Before I start the story, when I say the word Jesus, I want everybody to point up. Everybody try that. Are you listening? When I say Jesus, you're going to point up. When I say donkey, you're going to make donkey ears on your head. Show me your donkey ears. Two hands. There we go. This is Jesus. This is donkey ears. Okay? All right. Jesus was walking with his disciples toward Jerusalem. As they came near to the city, Jesus told two of his disciples to go ahead into the town. He told them he would see a young donkey tied there that had never been ridden. Untie the donkey and bring it to me. If anyone asks you what you are doing, just tell them the Lord needs it. He will send it back to you soon. The disciples did what Jesus told them to do, and it happened just as he had told them. They found the young donkey, untied it, and started to lead it away. Some men were standing nearby, and they said to the disciples, "Where are you taking that young donkey?" They told them that Jesus had said what Jesus had said, and the men let them take the donkey. The disciples brought the young donkey to Jesus, and they put their coats on it to make a soft place for Jesus to sit. As they made their way into the city of Jerusalem, people went ahead of Jesus, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Others followed behind, and they were also shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Hosanna in the highest!" All the while, people lined the streets, cheering and waving palm branches. Show me how to wave palm branches. It was a wonderful celebration, but it was a bit noisy. Do you think Jesus liked all that noise? Oh, I think Jesus loved all that noise, because they were celebrating. They were celebrating as he came into the city. It was kind of like his own personal parade. You like parades, right? Like the Blueberry Festival. Okay, after I read this Bible verse, we're going to celebrate however you want to celebrate. The Bible says, "This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." Celebrate! All right, let's bow our heads. Let's bow our head for prayer. Father, we celebrate today just as those people celebrated in Jerusalem 2,000 years ago. This is the day that you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
peace of Christ.
Killed and a number were injured.
Sometimes things escalate very quickly. So please pray for our church universal in these days. Are there any other prayers or concerns that you would like to lift up this morning?
I would like to thank the members of our church, of whom I'm very proud to be a member, for all the cards and letters and the prayers given to my way. I tell everyone, God bless you all, and thank you.
It's good to have you back. It's good to have Jim back, too. Hear now this call to confession. We come once again to a day of choice. We can walk with Jesus, or we may turn away. Now is a time of judgment for us. Like the crowds that proclaim Jesus as King, we sway back and forth. So let us look at ourselves again, examine who we are, and confess our sin before God. Let us pray together. Gracious and loving God, we confess that we would rather go along with the full flow of the crowd, proclaiming our undying faith in you one day, and backing away from it when someone confronts us or mocks us for it. It is a weakness we see in ourselves each and every day. Sometimes in the face of deep injustice or bone-deep suffering, we throw up our hands and declare that caring for the wider world is beyond our capacity. And yet you continue to call us to a new understanding, a new way of thinking and responding in the world. You bid us follow you, no matter where it takes us, and you continue to declare that your grace is sufficient for us, and your presence will be constant. We are afraid. Calm our fears, renew our hope, forgive our inconstancy, and make us again your new creation as we walk with you to Jerusalem. Amen. Let us pray silently now. Our assurance of pardon is in Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, and became obedient unto death on a cross. Through his obedience, we are freed from whatever bondage enslaves us. God, this morning, your servant, our Christ, comes among us, and we join the crowds who celebrate his coming. We raise our hands with songs of praise, and yet in only a few days, we know that these songs will turn into shouts of ridicule. And in the space of 1 week's time, Jesus will fall from glory to shame. We don't understand. We know that you sent Jesus to serve us, to save us, that we might learn to serve others, to save others. But we've gotten caught up in our own dreams and in our own lives, and we haven't always done what we should do, or even what we'd like to do. We find ourselves as one of the members of the crowd who so easily turn away. And so we're grateful for your forgiveness and pray that you will help us to follow him as faithfully as he followed you. Today, God, we offer you to those whom we have lifted up before you, names that are both spoken and unspoken. We pray for Donna Lamb, and we pray for those who are listed on our prayer list, and we ask that you bring comfort where it's needed, that you bring healing where it's needed, and that you bring peace where it's needed. We lift up to you as well this church and all your churches in this community and around the world. May we be bold in proclaiming your word, even in the midst of persecution. Especially protect those who are worshiping this day and throughout this Holy Week in places where there is violence and unrest. May your message be known. All these things we pray in the name of the one who taught us to pray together, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We'll just chat.
for just a little bit. We've been ascending for a couple of hours now, and whenever we see the Temple Mount, it feels good. It's like we're making progress. We've made this journey a number of times before. It's all well planned out. We know what we're doing. We know where we're going. And yet, it can be exhausting sometimes. It can be exhausting. I know the way you travel, you just hop in your car in a couple of hours, you'd be in Jerusalem. But I think that you're truly missing something in not traveling the way we do. All together as a community, enjoy this time. It can be pretty exciting. It's good. I will start out with one group of people, with family and friends, people who I know, and then I'll take a break, or they'll take a break, or we'll slow down, we'll get engaged in conversation, talk about all kinds of things. The time goes really fast. Then I'll step back in, we'll walk some more, and there'll be somebody new I can meet, somebody new to talk to. That's really good. It is a time of festival. It's a celebration time. Did I tell you where we're going? We're headed to Jerusalem for the Passover feast. And the younger generation, maybe in your day as well, they get kind of exuberant at times. But it's a good thing because it is a celebration. It's a good thing. But there are also some Roman soldiers who were walking along with us. And they're not so sure what we're doing. They're kind of watching. There's always the concern when our people gather together that there will be an uprising because they know we're not happy about the Roman occupation, but that's got nothing to do with what we're doing, nothing at all. It's not about that at all. And yet, they're concerned as they're watching, as they're walking along. Perhaps you don't really know a lot about the Passover, and so I'm going to tell you just a little bit about it. It's a time where we celebrate, where we give thanks for God's love for us, and that God saved us from slavery, from captivity in Egypt. You may remember the story how Moses would go to Pharaoh and Moses would say, "Let my people go." And Pharaoh would agree, and then he'd change his mind and he wouldn't let our people go. And so God sent plagues into Egypt, and they were awful things. And they would soften the heart of Pharaoh because people were suffering. And he'd say he'd let our people go, but then he didn't. He wouldn't do it. He changed his mind. And then finally, the last plague, the Spirit of God passed over Egypt, and the firstborn son in every Egypt household died. But God instructed the children of Israel to sacrifice a lamb and to take the blood of that lamb along the door frame of their home. And the Holy Spirit, the Spirit, would pass over that home. And so all of the sons of Israel were saved. But the sons of Egypt, everyone from the slave girl's oldest son to Pharaoh's oldest son, died. Pharaoh had a thick skull. It took him forever to get it, but finally he let our people go. Now, from our perspective today, we can look back and see that God was working through Pharaoh so that Pharaoh and Moses and God's people would see, would know, would understand beyond a shadow of doubt that God is in charge and no one else. God redeemed God's people. God set us free. And so that's what we celebrate in the Passover. Day of Thanksgiving. It's a time of celebration. It's great. And that's what we're doing, and we're enjoying our journey. But I tell you, something happened just a little bit ago that kind of took my breath away, that really surprised me. We were walking along, and we were near that wide Roman road that leads to Tiberias, and the narrower road that comes from Bethany. And from behind us, there came a whole group of people that were waving palms, and they were singing, and there was a lot of energy and a lot of activity there. And my youngest daughter, Naomi, said, "Mom, let's step aside. They're moving faster than we are. Let's just let them go through." And I said, "That's a good idea. Let's do that." So we stepped back. And we watched the crowd, and it was great, because there were men, and there were women, and there were children kind of running all over the place, and there were dogs in the parade, and they were chasing on the heels of the children. There were some men there that were trying to get things organized. You know, you go, that wasn't working. It wasn't working at all. You can kind of get that. But all of this activity, palms going. And then we noticed in the distance that there was a donkey coming between them. And he was just a young thing. It wasn't like a steady forward movement, but he was kind of skittering, kind of dancing back and forth, it seemed like. And there's this man sitting on him. And they're moving forward, and that's obviously who everybody was focused on. He was the center of the parade. And Naomi, she's looking that direction, and she goes, "That's our brother Jesus! That's our brother Jesus!" And they don't have things like glasses in our day. They don't have LASIK surgery, that kind of thing. And I'm trying to focus and see, and she's right. It's Jesus. It's my son. It's Jesus. It had been several years since he left home. I knew it was coming eventually, and I knew he'd been planning it for some time, and yet it kind of came as a surprise when it happened. John and his disciples, came into town and was talking to people, and it's always fun to hear about John. Sweet John, he was the pride and joy of his mother and father, and he was now wearing a camel hair vest and eating locusts and wild honey. And he would go around and he would tell people about God, and he was baptizing people in the river and telling them that God would forgive them. God would forgive them for all of their sins. It was kind of a peculiar thing of John, and yet it was a wonderful thing. So Jesus listened to this, and I could tell that something was happening. And so one night he pulled me and James, his younger brother, and I together, and we had a long talk, lasted into the night. He had it all planned out. He had it worked out. James would take on the responsibilities of being the oldest son. He would make sure that the business was all being what the business needed to be, and Jesus was leaving. I wasn't worried about the business. The business would be just fine. What I worried about was Jesus. I always knew he was special. I always knew from the very beginning. You all do something like blood tests or whatever to find out that you're going to have a baby. I had an angel who came to me and told me. And I was really afraid when that angel first came. Oops, I missed one. When the angel first came, I mean, totally unexpected, right? But the angel appeared and said, "Don't be afraid. The Lord has found favor with you. God has found favor with you. And you are going to give birth to a son who will be a special man. He will redeem your people, Israel. He will make a difference in the world." And then I said, "How can that be? I'm a young girl. I'm not married. I've not been with a man." And the angel said to me that the Holy Spirit would come upon me. The power of God would overshadow me. And as anxious and as hard as my heart was beating just a few moments before, I had this peace that settled upon me. And I knew that it would be okay. I just knew that it would be okay. And so I said to the angel, "Let it be as you say. I am God's servant." Now, most women who carry a prince in their belly are treated pretty well. People take good care of them. Things were difficult for me and for my family. It worked out, but there were challenges along the way that we wouldn't have expected, really, or maybe we would have. When Joseph heard the news, his first response was to quietly divorce me, which was not all that unexpected. And if you know about betrothal, it's a very serious thing in our culture. It's like being married, and he was going to quietly divorce me. But then the angel of the Lord went to Joseph and told him that the child I was carrying was God's son. And immediately, Joseph came to me, and he took me to his home, and he took care of me, and he loved me, and he treated me as his wife. We didn't sleep together until after Jesus was born, but he cared for me deeply. And I knew that. Joseph loved God. He loved me. He loved Jesus. Joseph is gone now, and I miss him so. When Jesus was born, all these unexpected things. His birth was announced by angels and shepherds and wise men from a long way away came and brought gifts. And they were led by a star. Isn't that amazing? Totally unexpected. And then when we took Jesus to the temple to be dedicated, there was an old man there. We'd never met him before. We never saw him before. But he saw us, and he instantly knew who we were, and he came to us, and he held his arms out, and he wanted to hold Jesus. And, you know, you don't just hand your baby to anybody, but I knew that I could do that. And I gave Jesus to this old man, Simeon, and he took Jesus in his arms. And he began to sing and to dance around with Jesus. And he said, "Now I can die in peace because I have seen the Lord's salvation." And then he blessed Jesus. And he blessed Joseph and I. And he said that there would be challenges in the nations, that through this baby, people would rise and fall, and that what was in their hearts would be revealed. And then he looked straight at me, and he said, "And a sword will pierce your heart also." I didn't know exactly what that meant. Jesus, as an infant, what a beautiful baby there. Oh, beautiful baby. This is my baby. It's beautiful. And I would bathe him as the water poured over him. Love of my heart. Flesh of my flesh. What are you going to do in God's name? I would pour the water over his hands. I'd wash those tiny little hands. And I'd kiss his palm and I'd say, what is God going to do with these hands to redeem the people of Israel? I'd wash his cute little baby feet. I'd kiss him and he'd giggle and say, where will these feet go to redeem the people of Israel? He's a good boy. As he was growing up, he'd work in his father's shop. He was lots of fun. He was funny. He was responsible. His father and I were so proud of him. When he was 12 years old, a Passover feast, just like what we're preparing for, walking to today, we went to the Passover feast, and everything went really well until we were headed home. We were pretty close to home, actually, and Joseph and I were walking around, like I said, we talked to different people, we kind of would lose track of each other, but then we'd find each other again, and I saw Joseph. Is Jesus with you? No, I thought he was with you. No, I thought you. Then, okay, let's wait just a little bit longer, and then we ought to be looking for him. And he didn't appear, and we started asking people, have you seen Jesus? No, I haven't seen Jesus. Have you seen Jesus? No, I haven't seen Jesus. We started backtracking. And we went all the way back to the temple. It was 3 days that this 12-year-old was gone. Think about how you would feel if your 12-year-old was gone for 3 days. We didn't know what to do. We went to the temple. And there he was. I was so relieved. I charged toward him, ready to kill him. Joseph put his arm out and said, stop, wait, look. Look at what's happening. Look at what he's doing. And he was in the middle of the teachers of the temple, and they were talking about scripture. Jesus was asking questions, and they were treating him really seriously. He's only 12 years old. But this was a really deep, important conversation. We just watched him and were amazed. Later, scolded Jesus and said, you need to tell us where you are. We were scared to death. And he said, didn't you know I'd be in my Father's house? Well, no, Jesus, you didn't tell us. Sometimes it was a little complicated raising the Son of God. Jesus, as he's traveled around, there are periods of time, long periods, where we haven't seen him, but we've heard about him, heard the things that were happening. We heard that he was with John and that John had baptized him in the River Jordan. And then we heard that John was killed by Herod. And I grieved that young man, and I feared even more so for our son. Jesus, I know he's my son. We say these things. He is so talented. People come from all over to listen to him teach. He is such a good storyteller. He tells these wonderful stories that really engage people as he teaches them about who God is. He's got his own disciples that follow him. Wherever he goes, he's got these 12 plus people who are always there learning from him too. James, my younger son, he's there now too. I kind of knew that was going to happen. I always look to and admire his older brother, so that's not all that unexpected. Not too long ago, the rest of us, we all went, we knew Jesus was close, and we all went to see him. We missed him. Jesus was busy, and he said to the crowd that was there, "Who is my mother? Who is my father? Who are my brothers and my sisters?" "You are my brother. You are my sister. You are my mother." He wasn't talking about us. He was talking about the crowd that was there. It's listening. And yet, I knew deep inside what he was saying. And I knew God was with him. I mean, Jesus calmed the storm. He healed people. He raised people who couldn't walk before. He caused a blind person to see. He raised a person from the dead. Obviously, God is working through him. People are watching. There are some, he's really challenging the authorities. He's saying that God's way is above our laws. And that's upsetting people. They come mad. There are some that are saying that he's a radical. There are some saying that he's trouble. There are some who say he's the Messiah, that he's the Son of God. He's my son. I love him. I'm worried about him. I prayed for him. I pray that Allah will keep him safe from harm. So the parade is going past us, and I realized it was Jesus, and I immediately put my hand over my mouth because I couldn't trust myself. I knew I shouldn't call out to him. But he looked my direction, and he smiled. He saw me. And you know, sometimes you can see the little kid in your adult child, and it was one of those moments. I saw my son, and he turned his head back toward Jerusalem and continued on his way. Naomi and everybody who was with them, they were so excited to join in the parade, and we all ended up with palm branches in our hands, and I had a smile on my face, but oh my gosh, inside, feels like it's going to break. I pray to God that perhaps once again the Lamb will redeem us. Once again, perhaps the Lamb of God will redeem us. I don't understand how, but that gives me the strength, the encouragement that I need as we continue our journey to Jerusalem.
Will we offer transportation, the witness of our voices, the clothes off our backs? These gifts are a sign of the offering of our entire selves. Let's just put it in form.
Thank you.
Let's pray together. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Blessed are the gifts that are received in Christ's name.
We come before you, O God, with the many blessings that you have bestowed upon us.
Use what we bring so that others may shout, Hosanna, Christ reigns. Amen.
Let's join in Hosanna, loud Hosanna. Good news. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.